My name is Jesse Garcia, and I'm here to introduce you to Team 2 and our IPD final presentation and our product called the Smarter RX. So just a little rundown about who our team is. Diane Maddy, she's our distance ed. She did all our finance. Harry was our technology manager. Matthew Bilski was our team leader and production manager. I was in charge of marketing, and Marcella Zabla was in charge of design. So just our presentation for you today, just our agenda. We're gonna do a little introduction. We're gonna go through our opportunity description and mission statement, go through our target market and customer needs, go through our concept and product description, a little bit about forecast and marketing plan, financial feasibility, risk analysis, and then summary and conclusion for Q&A. All right.
So this is the process we went through. As of now, I would say we're in the build and test models and prototype stage. How we got to our product, a lot of it was based on personal experience. We know a lot of people that take a lot of medications a week or a day, so we see them struggle sometimes up to an hour sorting out the pill boxes once a week, and it's a lot of a hassle. So we looked at current pill boxes out there. We realized that there's either, and I'll get into this a little bit later, there's either really simple, cheap solutions or really expensive, complicated ones, so we kind of went for a happy medium. We were also concerned with safety because they don't, anybody can have access to the medications, and we just think, since people who take a lot of medications a day, they have so much stress going on, and we're looking for something that would ease their life in some way. So we looked at the competition out there. As I said, there's a simple 7-day one. There's extremely complicated ones that are a little bit overpriced, and a lot of these don't have the authentication method that we put into ours. So we created a pill box that will portion dispense and remind users to take their medications. It'll simplify the medication regimens for the users. Our target market is really those adults over 18 that take more than 5 pills daily and use smartphones. The reason for the smartphone being, we figured a lot of people already have one anyway, so it's not something completely new they're adding into their daily life. It's something that's already there, and we're just adapting the medication to their already daily habit. The secondary market would be nursing homes, clinics, and pharmacies, and the stakeholders would be users, manufacturers, financers, team members, and advisor, distributor, and retailers. With that, Diane will talk about target market and customer needs.
Okay, thank you, Marcella. Can I have the next slide, please? So as Marcella already discussed, our primary market is to target those adults that are over 18 that take more than 5 pills daily and use smartphones. So in order to quantify that market, we determined that more than 37% of Americans age 60 and over and more than 8% of Americans age 20 to 59 take more than 5 prescription drugs per day based upon the Center and Disease Control and Prevention data. May I have the next slide, please? We then used the 2010 U.S. Census to determine the number of Americans in those age groups, and we were able to exclude those in skilled nursing facilities from our population. And may I have the next slide, please? And the PEW Research Center has recently done a survey in February 2012 determining how many people are using smartphones, and right now over 46% of adults own smartphones. May I have the next slide, please? So multiplying all of those parameters out, we were able to determine our target population of just over 10 million. May I have the next slide, please? So we determined that we have 10 million potential customers for our product. The next slide, please. In order to identify our customers' needs, we conducted phone and in-person interviews, and we published an online questionnaire. We had 27 patients and caregiver and one pharmacist answer the questionnaire of various age groups. May I have the next slide, please? Based upon the questionnaire, we ranked and weighted our customers' needs. We found that many of the responses confirmed our research up front and that there's a need for an affordable, portable pill box that's easy to use and that will remind users to take their medication. May I have the next slide, please? And now I'm going to hand it back over to Marcella and to Matt to talk about our concept and product description.
Thanks, Diane. So these are sort of the products that we looked to as what was already out there to try to get what was good about them, try to figure out what wasn't working and come up with our own product. So like we've already mentioned a little, we went through the functional diagram, figured out what we wanted to put into it, we wanted to get out of it, and we came up with a customizable pill dispenser, assisting with the loading of pills, keeps each medication separate, reminds the user when and how to take each medication, it logs both prescription and takes inventory, and it has the authentication method for safety that we talked about, and a removable cartridge. And with that, Matt will talk about it more.
Hi there. So I'm going to talk about our solution to the pill cartridge problem. So we have three basic parts plus a smartphone app to our system. We have the cartridge, which people would recognize as your standard 7-day pill holder. They're great at holding pills. We don't need to reinvent the wheel. Then we have the docking station. This right here is actually the brains of the entire system. It has our sensors, and it's what actually talks to the smartphone. And the final solution is the base station. That holds the extra medications, the extra pills, and also facilitates with loading in addition to charging the docking station. Next slide. So our cartridge, as I said, is a standard 7-day pill holder. They all have RFID tags in them, which allows our docking station to know which cartridge is in at a given time. They hold 7 doses, and because they all are uniquely identified, you can have different cartridges for different users, multiple cartridges per user. So inside the base station, we have our microcontroller brain. It's battery operated with Bluetooth, and on the bottom here are contacts that allow it to actually communicate with our base station. Our base station facilitates the loading through the funnel here, and using these little pins up top communicates with the docking station. There is no controller in here. All the controlling is done from the docking station. It also holds and secures the extra medication. And we have an Android app that actually is the user interface. There's no need to put a new interface on here. People already have these wonderful pieces of technology with beautiful screens, and so we're adding on to their phones, allowing them to interface their medication lives with their technology lives. And now for a demonstration of a typical user interacting with our product. So you would have your initial cartridge docked on, stays on nice, easy, and you flip your power switch, and it goes into warm-up mode. So you have the lights going. On our phone, we open up our app, and we launch the app. The app will then communicate with the phone, and the lights will blink twice once it initiates communication. We choose our user, and we enter our authentication. Wrong password won't let you in. So if we enter our password, it'll bring us to the home screen. So if we were to take a dose when we weren't using the pill holder, because this is still a pill holder, it would say, well, you took that dose while I wasn't here. Did you mean to do that? And if we say yes, it knows it was done and moves on with its merry day. So say we come home from the pharmacy with some new red pills. We have our pill box docked in our docking station, and we need to unlock it so that we can get inside. Say we picked up 25 pills at Rite Aid. We'd enter a refill into our phone. The system thinks we have, let's say, 30 red pills to start. We tell it we picked up red pills. We picked up 25 more. It now knows that we have 55 red pills in stock.
Can I see the overhead camera? Is that on the...
Yep. And now let's take a pill. Let's go through, I need to take my evening dose on Tuesday evening. So the phone would remind you to take the pills in the flashing bin. The Tuesday bin is flashing right now.
Professor.
I open it. I take out the pills. And then the phone notices that I took the pills and from telling me to take them and thanks me for having taken my pills. Now I'll go through a method of loading. So we want to load a cartridge. We can store extra cartridges inside of here. There's slots. They're spring-loaded, so it makes it easier to take them out. And there's also plenty of room to hold the pill bottles. This entire area is secure, locking and unlocking only with the app. So we put in our empty cartridge, it docks on, and we put it into the base station. And I tell it I want to load cartridge. Let me move this hole under the camera for people. Load cartridge. So it tells me I need to put one more red pill into this spot. So I put a red pill in. I need a red pill in here. I need a red pill in here. But now it wants me to put purple pills into the other slot. So I put a purple pill in. Tells me I need another purple pill. And it tells me I don't need any more. But let's say I make a mistake and add one extra purple pill. And I miss two. So it slides all the way over and asks me to kindly remove one extra pill from the flashing bin. Now, it's also tracking how many of each pill is left. And then it reminds us that we're running low on purple pills and it's time to actually refill our prescription. When we're all done, we can tell it to lock. And you have an issue. This is a solenoid, so if you don't shut the door and it goes up, well, you're not going to be able to shut the door, but we have a wonderful sensor in place that the door won't lock until after it's shut. Now, this whole unit is what we call fail secure, which means if the power goes out, it's still locked. But there's a very simple solution to that. We include a key also, so that if the power goes out, you don't know where your phone is, you still have access to your medications. Now we'll move on to Jesse to talk about our marketing plan.
All right, thanks. So just going into our sales forecast and where we see this going, we look at year one and two and we incorporate those 10 million customers that we want to attain. We hope with our marketing and advertising initiatives we can increase, we have a 20% awareness and incorporate the 50% probability of attaining those customers and hopefully having a total unit sold by end of year one and two of 10,000. By year three and four, 15,000, and by the end of year five, up to 20,000 units sold. And that will correlate with the awareness increasing due to marketing initiatives. Breaking down our marketing and support cost a little further, we realized that we need a full-time professional to attain our goals with sales. We'll be supported with a part-time staff. We'll cover our cost to host and maintain our website because that is our main sales channel. And then advertising is $1,000 per month, and computer and office is also incorporated into this. We benchmark the advertising price based off of Diane, our distance ed, personal understanding of marketing through her company. And then just our personal initiatives, just reminding you that we are looking at a smartphone user. We understand that they're internet savvy, so we're really going to look into multiple channels. For ad sales, usually through Google, Bing, WebMD, really optimizing their search engine to focus on our product. We could attain listservs from potential doctors or pharmacies to email blasts to get our idea out there. And then because we are using an Android app, we are looking into an Android app marketplace channel. And then lastly, patient recommendations are crucial in regards to the devices that they use to hold their pills. So inbound marketing, so having that personal touch, whether through social media or through blogs, to get our idea out there. And now Diane is going to talk about financial feasibility.
Thank you. In order to determine the financial feasibility, we've prepared a base case financial model. May I have the next slide, please? This is just a close-up view of the previous slide. We anticipate the project generates a net present value of approximately $822,000 with an internal rate of return of 90% based upon the following assumptions. May I have the next slide, please? Just as already spoken to our marketing and support costs, we anticipate development costs that are primarily programming for the app and the engineering costs associated with the project, as well as some people time. These costs are spread over the first three quarters. May I have the next slide, please? Ramp-up costs are primarily in the second and third quarters. We believe that these costs are very conservative estimates for the cost of appropriating CNC equipment and injecting molding equipment, because we do think that we'll likely outsource the rent facility since our production quantities really don't warrant the capital investment, but we did budget for some capital investment if required. We also anticipate some tooling reworking costs might be required, so we put some money in for that as well. Next slide, please. In order to determine our production costs, we prepared a bill of materials. We did prepare a full bill of materials for purchase parts. This is just a close-up of some of that bill of materials. We have a prototype price and a bulk price based upon purchasing. Typically, our bulk pricing we were able to find for 100 units. However, we're manufacturing quantities of 10, 15, and 20,000, and there'll be additional quantity economies of scale that we're going to be able to achieve. So we priced out our bill of materials based upon the manufacturing quantities in order to determine what we believe it will cost to manufacture at those levels. Next slide, please. We did perform a build versus buy analysis for many parts. This is just an example of two of those workups. We considered the fixed costs such as tooling and variable costs such as material and processing. And in these examples shown, we determined it's more effective to manufacture the pill boxes, but it will be more cost efficient to purchase the funnels. Next slide, please. So what we did, and again, this is just a sample of our bill of materials. We took the cost to manufacture 10, 15, and 20,000 for both purchase parts and for our make parts. We added some the cost of assembly to assemble the entire product together, and we came up with our total cost to produce. We think that the first 2 years at a 10,000 quantity, it'll cost us just over $48 to produce. Years three and four, it would cost just under $39, and in year five, it will cost just over $33 to produce this item. May I have the next slide, please? This chart illustrates our period cash flow, and we would anticipate generating positive cash flow in quarter four. The next slide, please. And if we look at it on a cumulative discounted cash flow basis, we will break even in quarter four of year two, and our maximum cash outlay is just under $300,000 in quarter three. Next slide, please. We're now just going to briefly touch on risk analysis. The next slide, please. And from a financial standpoint, we performed a sensitivity analysis on each of our base case model assumptions to see the impact on net present value. And it's clear that our model is very sensitive to the number of units produced and sold, the sales price per unit, and the unit cost per unit sold. And on the next slide, we have a tornado diagram showing the sensitivity of those items. And we have a line showing where our base case net present value would be. And now Harry will continue on.
Thank you, Dana. Continuing the risk analysis, we observed the hazardous characteristics of our pill dispenser, and of which we classified the hazards as cuts, punctures, bruises, crushings, and strains, which the probability is very low, and few of them are, you know, not possible. So this says our product is safe. Next slide, please. Identifying the malfunction failures, we found the electronic malfunctions are like software, and app errors, sensors may not respond, and there might be a design malfunction like the spillage of pills between funnel and box, and environmental effects like fading of external paint. And next slide, please. And we have studied a failure mode and effects analysis for 25 parts of our pill dispenser, and the two manufacturing processes, and two assemblies, of which we found the risk priority number is very high for the software, and then to the maintenance and manufacturing processes. Next slide, please. In order to decrease this risk, we have to update and debug the software periodically and release new updates for this app, and notification signs should be included all around the our pill dispenser for better maintenance. And after this risk analysis, our next steps are full app development after releasing our product to the market, and designing manufacturing processes, and getting funding from our stakeholders and customer feedback, which is very important to improve the design of our pill dispenser. And the conclusion of our presentation is we present our SmarterX to our stakeholders, which is safe, which is portable, which is which has authentication system and has a affordable price range, and now we are ready for questions. Thank you.
Yeah. Does your cost analysis? I didn't get the full details. What do you factor in for product liability insurance? Because I would think that's extremely high in this case.
Diana might help us with this.
That's a very good point, and we do need to consider that. We have not considered that in our analysis at this time.
And then my next question would be, you have the 10 million users. I didn't really get the connect that at one point I heard in the thing, you know, you figured a lot of people have smartphones. I understand there was some data on smartphones, but specifically, did you look at the data of the people who take the pills and have smartphones? An example being, I think the majority of the people taking five pills a day or more are in their 80s and 90s, and I think they're also the majority of the people who would not have a smartphone. So I'm just wondering, is that, does that number take those two factors into consideration?
If you go to slide number 11, we were able to go through by age group and determine the percentage that owned smartphones and apply it to the various age groups. So, for example, we were able to ascertain that 13% of those over 65 owned smartphones. So we were able to also ascertain that 37% of that population have to take more than five prescription drugs per day.
Great. That's what you wanted, right?
That's what I wanted to hear. Yeah, yeah. That's good.
That's good.
Good answer.
Thank you.
I was really impressed with the demo.
Yeah.
Yeah.
For something that you didn't have last week.
Not really.
I mean, they had bits and pieces.
Yeah. It was close.
And again, I don't want to tear you down having built you up. But there's no way in hell my wife would want that in my house because of the aesthetics.
Right. It isn't prototype aesthetics. We would work with industrial design and all that.
Is the funnel necessary? Is the funnel counting?
There's a sensor in here, an electric guide. When you walk through the dry cleaners, the ding, same thing happens here.
Okay.
That's detecting the drop. But again, the design of it right now is to demonstrate the functionality. It could be reworked. There's different ways to accomplish the same goal here. And the other concept is that from day to day, the only thing you're ever really interacting with is this right here. This could be in a closet, this could be hidden. So it's basically an enclosure of your pill cabinet already. So this would be what you carry around with you. Or say you could just take this, and then when you put it on here, then it updates your phone as to what you did. Mr. Dunn.
I think one of your biggest things that you've been saying is portability. Of those people that take more than five pills a day, how many of them need to take them throughout the day? Do you know that? Like, I take three pills every morning, but I don't think I would need this. So people that take need five pills a day, what's to say they don't just need them all in the morning or morning and at night and wouldn't necessarily need to take this anywhere?
Yeah, it's just really talking to personally with individuals. Like, I know my best friend, she's 24, has cancer. Really sad, statement, but she has to take pills throughout her day. And this is really the market. Like, we're looking at really sick individuals who do have smartphones, whether they're, 24 or 60. There's people with, this problem. And from my understanding is that she's taking pills constantly. And if she's not, and, she has chemo brain, or like how Diane has described it in previous experiences, that they really need to have something like this or to assist them with their distribution of pills.
And along with portability.
And when we did our customer survey, that was one of the things that we kept hearing, that people wanted to be able to take their pills with them either just for the day or if they're going away for the weekend. They don't want to have to take the entire pill box with them. They don't want to have to take the entire thing. They want to be able to load something up and go and be able to be reminded that, gee, you have to take these pills now. So that was one of the things that we did get in our customer feedback.
Something I would just like to put is, this is an inch and a half thick right now, probably 2 inches, because that's with me making a one-off what's necessary to put all the circuitry in here. In reality, this could be a half inch thick. So we looked at it as people are already carrying around this. If you add just a little bit to it, just say the lower section of this to it, it's really not a significant increase in size when you're already dealing with a cumbersome device.
Yeah, that was kind of my point, is I could see how, and I don't want to be sexist, but I could see how a woman could hide that in her purse or something along those lines. How is a man going to carry that around?
How does he already carry this around?
He doesn't. He just
exactly. Yeah. So his solution, he already has some sort of bag.
His man purse.
Right. His briefcase, a backpack. Central. There's already some methodology in his daily routine for carrying around a bulky item. So if we make it a little bit bulkier.
A backpack.
How about competition?
Well, in terms of, aside from, there's a You could buy this round, square, cube. There's a million different ways to make this simple one. We found other devices. I guess there's ePill.com, and they have devices like this that are $1,000. And they're fully automated. But the way we look at it is, something humans are really, really good at is picking stuff up like this. It costs a machine a lot of money to be able to pick up little things. We're trying to take the thought out of people's, prescription would be in the phone already. So we're using people's strengths, which is manipulation of items, and making it semi-automatic, so it's guiding you. So that lowers our cost. So we're in a different market. We're in the semi-automatic market, making this an affordable option versus the $1,000 you probably need insurance reimbursement, all of this, where this could be something where, you know what, I'd give that a try. It could make my life easier.
So two questions. One, as you looked at the percent of your target market that has smartphones, one important thing will be to look at the rate of adoption, because the market's not static. So, you know, what has happened over the past year, what's anticipated over the next year, and how quickly will that change? The question, as you look at lateral benchmarking, how other facilities or healthcare providers dispense medications, did you look at what nursing homes or what hospitals or pharmacies do, and do they have any similar type of product on a larger scale that is being used that could be pared down for the home use?
$1,000 machines.
One pharmacy.
Go ahead.
We did speak to one pharmacy, and the pharmacy is actually wanted me to show the video of the prototype once we had it available. A lot of the local pharmacies here in Long Island, at least, contract out with nursing homes where they actually go ahead and they prepackage and they pre-fill for the nursing homes, and they are looking for an easier, better way that they can program something in there and have it done for them, or have it have assistants doing this. So we think that that could be a good secondary market for us, that we could look at pharmacies or go right to the nursing homes themselves and say, if you have X number of patients, you can program all of these patients in there, and this will just help automate the process rather than taking a long period of time, because it's very time consuming to set up all of these pill combinations.
So I have a question. A comment first. I agree with John that the demo was great. It really helped convey exactly what you were doing. And the balance between automation and affordability, you know, that's a really tough one to figure out where to go. And, you know, you've made some reasonable calls there, right? There's compromises all up and down. So I really applaud that. Nice job. I didn't hear much about the marketing strategy, or at least as much as I was hoping I might hear. Can you talk a little bit? This is a really dense market, so it's good and bad, right? It's dense because there's a huge need. Clearly, people really want stuff that helps make this problem go away. Big problem. But because it's such a dense market, you know, there's so much noise, how are you going to get through it? What's the plan to sort of get it out there?
Yeah, that's, you know, because we're looking at a niche market, essentially, because it's really sick individuals who, you know, who are internet users or smartphone users, we really want to use, medicine is often the doctor's your channel for a product or understanding, but we want to make sure that our presence online is really our key entryway to that. And we focused on an inbound marketing strategy, because from sitting down and hearing feedback or getting survey feedback, we know that these patients talk to other patients, and they know that they use different pill holders and different devices. And because we're using that personal inbound approach through blogging and almost like a guerrilla marketing type of entryway into the internet, you get that personal feedback and you get the awareness out there on a patient level.
As a corollary, you have, for, let's say, cancer patients or very sick individuals, there is a lot of group meetings and people helping each other. And between working with the doctors who interface, if we help explain to the doctors how this could make their patients' lives easier, then we have one patient whose life is made easier by this. And then they go to their support group. And on a day-to-day basis, I don't know if I'm personal, but I'm sure there's not too many things that, well, this might help me feel better, but here's something that actually helped my life. So then they tell it. So again, this might be like an exponential growth where it's hard to initially get our feet in, but we are confident that this is something that can make people's lives a lot easier in these situations, and that will help kind of spread
word. And the awareness is a gradual increase based on what we assumed with our sales. For year one and two, we do a 20% awareness or goal for attaining that, and then by year three, it's only 30%. So we know that it's a slow process to get this information out there.
Just a quick observation. One of your target market ideas was to go after people with smartphones. So they're sort of savvy and tech savvy, and they're probably using apps. And mm-hmm. right, so the coolness factor probably will play a role. So the design of the thing, the coolness factor. I have this really cool app that takes a picture of wine bottles that I've just drunk, and it actually can identify what wine it is and then go search it out. I wonder if a similar thing might work for this, where you could just take a picture of whatever pill bottle you brought home. It automatically identifies how many pills are in there. So, you know, all those little things you were doing, if you could eliminate 15 of those entry steps with the
We were working into that through OCR technology, organic character recognition, I think. That would let you read the labels. The problem right now is there's no standard. When you buy something at the supermarket, it's got a UPC code. That does not carry across different pharmacies. If you take out your barcode app on your phone, it doesn't take you. But there are indices. You have the PDR, which has a picture of every pill. So with the new electronic health record push, we'll have doctors e-prescribing, and that will download into the system, getting people's prescriptions in. And if we do work with the pharmacies with adding RFID capabilities, because this will have RFID built in, so either if it's got an RFID tag, you touch it to the pill box. So whether that, or we do just actually scan the pill box and interpret the characters. As we bring this to market, I'm very confident that new technologies and also new partnerships with those companies.
But there's, you know, what gets printed on the outside of those pill boxes, especially prescription ones, are, you know, there's numbers that you probably could have a little logic to search for, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
I would ask that you consider getting rid of everything. What did you call the thing right below the pill box? What did you call that?
The docking station.
The docking station.
Yeah.
Does it make sense to take the docking station and the pill and get rid of everything else?
The loader?
Everything else. And have a smart pill box, basically, that reminds me to take the pills that I'm supposed to be taking three times a day and gives me an app that says I didn't do it or I did do it, and then I can go back and fill it and so on and have all the smart stuff that you showed and eliminate all the other stuff, maybe as a first entry into the market and maybe build onto that.
It's a very modular system, so that would be an option if we decide the first thing we want to do is you go and you buy this.
Mm-hmm.
But then for the users who do want something to make it easier, because it is quite tedious to have to make sure you get it. So some users might want to pay the extra $20, because this right here costs the same as this. There's very little, just a piece of sheet metal in reality and a little motor. So people might want to add that on, and it's a very modular system. In addition, you can buy as many of these as you want. So that'd be a very good approach to getting to market very quickly.
You guys have any feedback? Because I know it's a very tedious process just to load your pills into that little pill box as is. Do you have any feedback from the tech-savvy people who are very sick on doing this? I mean, I think this will actually take longer because you have to read per step to go versus you know it. Any feedback from anyone? Yeah, or the consideration?
If you look at that drawer, remember the slide that we have?
Yeah.
We have a slide with a drawer. That's a 57-year-old man who has cancer. On the left-hand side, you'll see his pill drawer. He takes 14 pills a day, and what he's done is he's modified a two-week just regular pill box to hold a month's worth of pills. It takes him over an hour at the beginning of each month to set that up, and very often, because his regimen changes, he needs to redo it, and then he takes another hour to take pills out and put them in. So his feedback when we showed him the video was that this would definitely cut down on his time, especially if he's tired or what Jess said, if he has chemo brain and is just not thinking properly. It would definitely be beneficial to have something to help him figure out how to load the pills, because it is a very time-consuming process when you have that many pills to load.
And as a corollary, I'm a firm believer in the philosophy that life is a software issue. And once we have this hardware platform working with the people who are going to be using it, we can work on the algorithms, because it's just a line of code if we do one pill at a time, if it tells you which. That's all tweaks that we can have five different versions and have five different people. So that would all come from continuous testing.
Shannon Gregory, you have a question?
One last question. Go ahead, Jen.
Yes. Real curious. In essence, this is a medical device. Will it need FDA approval? Because I know there are some automatic pill dispensers out there that have been FDA approved.
Does it need FDA approval?
I don't know if there's a specific answer, but looking at today's market with what you can make as a supplement versus a medical, there's ways around that, I'm sure. If this is a novelty item, you could go the FDA approval route, but I'm quite confident with some creative paperwork you could also avoid the FDA route. If you just, it depends on what title you put on the company. That's the sense I get for most products, FDA approval versus non-FDA approval.
I would assume that pill, plastic pill dispenser is not.
Yeah, I feel like it probably FDA just approval. Doesn't have the lead paint sticker. That's probably the approval it has.
All right. Thank you very much.